The ruling military has sacked six ambassadors, and security forces have tightened their crackdown on pro-democracy protesters, even as international pressure against this week's coup grows. The decision announced late on Wednesday on state media includes Sudan's ambassadors to the United States, the European Union, China, Qatar, France, and the head of the country's mission to the Swiss city of Geneva, apparently over their rejection of the military takeover. It came as demands are mounting for the army to walk back Monday's coup that derailed Sudan's fragile transition towards democracy following the removal of longtime ruler Omar al-Bashir in April 2019 in a popular uprising. On Wednesday, the African Union announced its decision to suspend Sudan from the bloc's activities until the restoration of the country's civilian-led transitional government, while the United States paused $700 million in emergency assistance and the World Bank froze aid. All right, I understand we have Bola Oba now, political analyst, as we turn to the events in Sudan. Good to have you join us, Bola Oba.
Wonderful, wonderful to be on your side, virtually.
All right, so it does look like now there is also a diplomatic crisis in Sudan. We understand that some countries, representatives of some countries like Norway, Germany, and France, went on a visit to the released Prime Minister Abdalla Hamdok. Some countries are also the envoys who were sacked by the military are saying they are not going to hand over to new envoys. That's all the diplomatic crisis amid a very fragile security situation in that country and political crisis. What do you make of this?
It's almost inevitable that what's happening now will happen. There's a major disruption of the interim constitutional order. We have a case of the coup, of a palace coup, a coup within a coup, what I have called Babangida's-like coup. There are some people who are loyal to the civilian authority. There are some elements, normally the military loyal to the military purchased. We also have a situation of one of the leaders of one of the militant groups in the country also in a very tepid, very fragile kind of alignment with the military purchase. But one fundamental thing that we can take away from the table is that the Sudanese, the average Sudanese, have gotten used to asserting their democratic rights or to using civil protest to push out authoritarians and totalitarians historically. So let's see how these two will end.
It's a really politically active society there in Sudan. But let's look at what's playing out now, especially how the international community is responding to this. We know that some time ago during the tenure of al-Bashir, that the U.S. placed Sudan on a list of countries that sponsors terrorism, and that made the country ineligible for funding by global institutions, debt relief, even potential foreign investment. Sudan was removed from that list in December 2020. But now we see that the U.S. is saying, look, we're not going to set $700 million in aid. The World Bank has froze aid as well. What does this new financial isolation mean for Sudan and Sudanese as well, who will be affected by this?
I'll be very honest with you, most purchased, most coupist, indeed, most people driven by vaulting ambition seldom care about such a major disruption. And, at this point in the world, people may not know that we have entered another Cold War. This Cold War now is between the United States of America, China, and Russia. Russia is literally doctrining China. And because the US and Western powers, especially countries like France and Britain, because they wouldn't want China and Russia to take advantage of what they may be needing, you would see like what happened in Guinea, like what happened in Mali, and you would see that ultimately this melodrama or this dramatization of respect for democracy may go on for a couple of days, but if the purchased were able to eventually find a strategy to contain the public outcry, ultimately, like we've seen in Mali, like we've seen in Guinea, like we've seen in Chad too, ultimately, it is very likely that the United States of America and all these other Western powers will find a way of just tapering out their so-called respect for democracy. At this juncture, my ultimate respect is placed on the activities of the average Sudanese asserting their preference for democracy relative to what is happening presently. I am not too taken, I am not too given to respecting what you, United States of America, and all other Western powers may do, because I have seen what happened in Chad, I've seen what happened in Mali, I've seen what happened in Guinea, that they ultimately, as a result of their fear of letting China and Russia take over their historic and colonial bestowed advantages, they find a way of tapering out their so-called adherence for democracy. And you know what? Your question may not really go in that direction. Because of what I've said now about France, about Western powers generally, because most of these countries, you know, up until Sudan, in Niger, in Chad, in Mali, in Guinea, France has the historical this thing with there.
And Mr. Gbolahagba, just to come in here, because of course it is the same situation in terms of a coup, but can you really liken the situation in Sudan with the situation in Mali and Chad, especially economically, knowing that Sudan is heavily dependent on the foreign financial support to keep its economy afloat? Don't you think that with this international pressure, especially the removal of the foreign financial support, that could force, or perhaps it could force the army to walk back the takeover and then move towards the transition to democracy?
I think your question is a bit tilting too much in the direction of optimism. In the case of Mali, Mali's economic situation is even worse than Sudan's. And even in the case of Mali, France has a 5,000 standing army within Mali. And yet, what ultimately happened when the second coup in Mali happened? France ultimately got hold because they don't ultimately want China and Russia to get some of the advantages. In fact, the government in Mali has started, because France says they'll be leaving, they'll be taking the Marines out of Mali early next year. And the government started negotiating with a security group in Russia. Look, we are at a point now where I don't believe in any of these Western powers helping us Africans assert, you know, the affirmation or the entrenchment of democracy. I've seen enough in the last 1 to 1.5 years, and I told you from Chad, you know, the total accommodation of, you know, what is inconsistent with constitutional order. You move from Chad to Mali, you move from Mali to Guinea, and I'm saying that your question is a bit more tilted in the direction of optimism, because ultimately in Sudan, the extent to which the Sudanese assert their respect or preference for democracy would matter. Not what anybody relies on, United States of America or any of the colonial powers to do. And this
perhaps
is a warning to the Nigerian political class that we used to believe up until 2 years ago, up until 3 years ago, that the Nigerian militarians will not misbehave because the international powers will be there to assert, you know, the entrenchment of democracy in Nigeria. But what we see in our neighborhood in recent times, Nigerian politicians, beware.
But perhaps we can count on the Sudanese people to keep fighting for their country as they have always done. I'm afraid we do have to leave it there. We do have to leave it there, Bolaba. Thank you so much for your insights as always. Thank you for talking to us, political analyst Bolaba.